Good afternoon, Jerusalem. We live in the heart of the city, where history is about to unfold. I am Josiah of Barca, one of your hosts for today.
And I'm Nafa Rahabia, your other host for today. Today is a special day as we host the first ever Palm Sunday Parade right here in Jerusalem.
Nafa, what are you expecting today with this new festivity?
I'm not so sure myself. Things were put together pretty quickly for today's celebration, but there seems to be a lot of excitement.
Do you know who came up with the idea for this event?
Joe, we don't know. But it began as a groundswell movement, and now everyone wants to be involved.
So would it be difficult to find out who to ask about the permit for the festival? Do they have one? Do you have one? According to the 12 tables of amendment of the 12 tables, the most ancient of Roman law, civilians are not allowed to live commentate unless the event in the question is due to the death. It's all a big conspiracy. A big conspiracy, I tell you.
All right, away with you, crazy conspiracy theorist. Okay. Let's take a moment to go to our location, Zach, for an update on a crowd that has been gathering all day. Zach?
Hey, Zach. What's it like down there on the streets as the people prepare for this Palm Sunday parade?
Yes, hello, you two.
Hey, Zach. What's it like down there as the people prepare for this Palm Sunday parade?
It's pandemonium out here. People are lining the streets waving palm branches. I've heard some rumors of some guy joining the parade.
Sounds crazy. Have you heard anyone mention who might be in the parade today?
I've heard some talk of a king being in the parade.
A king? How exciting. You know where he's from?
No one seems to know about that. But they're all anticipating a great and flashy procession. And they're hoping that he might share some of his wealth with those who are gathered along the road.
This is illegal. This is illegal, I say. He cannot do this. You would know this if you studied the law. Like I need to make sure I can live here without a visa.
Shoo, old lady! I'll try to get you a little closer so I can get a good look at it. And then I'll get back. This is Zach reporting on.
I think I can see the first of the parade coming.
Yes, there's a chariot moving to sight now.
Isn't it beautiful? I sure do love the gold trim along with the edges of the wheel. Can you see who's in the chariot?
Yes, I see now. It is the mayor of Jerusalem. This must be a special parade as the royal family is in the front. Let's go down to Joanna, our pastor police on the street.
Hello, Mutaya and Nava. What a gorgeous day for a parade! All the stores are out in anticipation of the king. Well, Nava, as I always say, you either know fashion or you don't. And to believe me, our mayor is dressed to impress. The mayor is in a classic desert sand-colored robe with sashes woven out of the finest silk of Persia. He is dressed for success. I love it. The craftsmanship of this chariot is stunning. The sides and rear are adorned with Egyptian gold, intricate carvings, and lined with the finest Arabian diamonds. This chariot is a testament to the wealth and influence of the mayor.
How marvelous.
Thanks, Joanna, for that report. We now move on because I can hear the sound of trumpets. That can only mean one thing.
Yes, Nava. The Jerusalem High School marching band is rounding the corner in full glory.
Just listen to those cymbals and drums.
And we're fixing on to kick up my sandals and dance around in the street.
Control yourself, Joe. What would the people think?
Okay, I'll settle down. Can you see the next group in the parade?
They're coming into view. I can see a random woman in cuffs. Wait, no, that's just something impressive. Next group seems to be a group of men walking slowly. They look a bit scruffy and dirty, though.
Or they're probably local, maybe fishermen, or some other lowly trade.
This group seems very out of place for this glorious parade. They're certainly not dressed for this grand day as we prepare a king.
Maybe they are just parade workers, you know, walking along to clean up after the animals and such.
Do you want me to give a report on their dreary attire of camel hair and leather? It is not given. I've seen better clothes on a...
Oh no, we don't need any more fashion reports.
Two words. Hate it.
I just wish that they would move on quickly. I don't want them to block my view of the king when he approaches.
Wait, Nava. I think something special is beginning to happen.
Yes, I can see the people spreading their clothes off on the ground.
And others are putting palm branches all along the road.
This is quite a sight.
Yeah, indeed. I hear shouts, but I can't make out what they're saying.
Sounds like a chant.
Is it Hail to the Chief?
No, sounds more like a reference to King David. This must be a special king that is a king.
I can't see anything for the crowd. Let's try to get to Zap again on the street for a closer look. Zap, are you there? What are you seeing?
I do see someone coming closer, but he's hard to make out. There are people all around him.
Can you tell what country he's from?
He looks very common, as if he could have grown up nearby.
What kind of monkeys are on his chariot?
He's not in a chariot, so you won't believe this, but he's riding on a donkey's colt.
A colt? Is this some sort of contemporary mode of travel for the king?
Don't think so. It just looks like a plain old donkey to me. No fancy saddle or accessories, just a few dirty blankets on his back for the man to sit on.
Is the king wearing a crown of gold and jewels?
He's got no crown or anything that would indicate royalty or wealth. Looks no different from any of the other people walking around on the street.
This is quite puzzling. There must be another, even better king following him. The people must not be so excited over this simple man coming into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey.
No one is following him. He's the last entry on the parade.
Well, this is certainly our left of you.
Yes, I thought we would be seen by a king of more notoriety and power.
Well, we have to remember, this is the first Palm Sunday parade, at least it gave the people of Jerusalem something to get excited about, even though the king was a bit of a disappointment.
Yes, and well, we thank you, Mel, for being with us today. And we will be back on the air this coming Friday with some special events going on at the nearby Gold Plaza.
Yes, Miles. We will be covering the crucifixion of several criminals on that day. We hear that one of them is an extremely radical rebel. We don't know a name at this point, but we will keep you posted as a hero.
And this is Josiah and Nava wishing you all a good day.
Jesus was going to do. I wonder whether Jesus knew what was coming later in the week as he rode into Jerusalem. I wonder how well I really know Jesus. Let us pray. God of love, as we come before you this day, help us to remember all that our blessed Lord endured for us, to remember how Jesus was betrayed and given up into the hands of wicked men. Lord Jesus, we remember today that it was one of your old familiar friends who betrayed you. And we know that there is nothing that so breaks the heart as the disloyalty of one whom we called friend. Grant that we may not betray you. Lord Jesus, we remember how you suffered death upon the cross. Help us to remember the lengths to which your love was ready to go. That having loved your own, you loved them to the very end. The love that which none can be greater. The love that lays down its life for its friends. That it was while people were yet enemies that you died for them. Oh God, help us to remember how Jesus now lives and reigns. Help us to remember that the crucified Lord is the risen Lord, that the cross has become the crown. So grant unto us to trust in his love and to live in his presence, that we may share in his glory. This we ask for your love's sake. Amen.
Good evening. The scripture reading for tonight has been taken from the Gospel, the book of Matthew, chapter 26, verses 14 through 19. Then one of the 12, the one called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and asked, What are you willing to give me if I deliver him over to you? So they counted out for him 30 pieces of silver. From then on, Judas watched for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Where do you want us to make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" He replied, "Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says, my appointed time is near. I am going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.'" So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them and prepared the Passover. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, is it I? 26, verses 26 through 30. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The third scripture reading is a follow-on from the last one. It's from the Gospel of Matthew 26, verses 31 to 46. Matthew 26, verse 31. Jesus predicts Peter's denial. Verse 31. Then Jesus told them, "This very night you will all fall away on life on account of me. For it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered.' But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee." Peter replied, "Even if all fall away on account of you, I never will." "Truly I tell you," Jesus answered, "this very night, before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times." But Peter declared, "Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you." And all the other disciples said the same. Gethsemane, verse 36. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet, not my will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for the 1 hour?" he asked Peter. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away a second time and prayed, My Father, it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it. May your will be done. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen.
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. with him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Do what you came for, friend." Then the men stepped forward and seized Jesus and arrested him. The word of the Lord.
Bribed him to turn Jesus in. I don't know what to do. Should I go after Jesus? Tell the high priest and the elders what a big mistake they're making? Jesus is the Son of God. He doesn't need me to help him. I'm sure he will do something to show them who he is. I bet he will call on fire from heaven. Or maybe he will stop up the bowels of the Pharisees until they blow up like old wineskins. Or even better still, Jesus will turn them all into pigs.
But what if he doesn't? What if he forgives them? He was always talking about forgiveness. And if he forgives them, will the high priest let him go? Or will they come after all of us for blaspheming, for following someone who claims to be the Son of God?
Do you know Jesus?
Aren't you one of them?
Aren't you one of Jesus' closest friends?
I don't know Jesus. Why are you asking me this? I promise you, I've never heard of him. Here they come with Jesus. And do they look good? But I know what he can do. I've seen the miracles. Maybe he is waiting for the right time to show them once and for all that he is the Son of God. He is looking at me right now. I know he can do it. I know he will do it. They'll see. Show them, Jesus!
Jesus.
Aren't you one of them?
Aren't you one of Jesus' closest friends?
I do not know this man. Why do you keep asking me this? I've never heard of him. I saw you in the garden with him. I do not know this man.
The others ran away.
I've never heard of him.
But you sneaked over here.
It wasn't me. I was never near.
Oh Lord, what have I done? I lied, and now you're gone. You knew that I would lie, and you were right. You warned me. I abandoned you. I didn't call you friend.
Pilate hands him over
to be crucified.
So the soldiers took charge of Jesus.
Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. They crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Good Friday.
What is good about the innocent one nailed to the cross? What is good about the darkness of war that persists today? What is good about our destination of the planet? About the people living in poverty? About the fog of addiction, depression, disease, and despair? What is good about crushing weight of hunger, racism, scapegoating, apathy? No, there's nothing good and desirable in these things.
I am a Roman centurion. I killed him. I administered the bloody beatings that he took. I mocked him. I spat on him, and I saw to it that he suffered greatly. And later, I hold up the spike in my hand, and I drove it into his. I heard him cry out in agony, and I didn't care. I plunged my spear into him to make sure the job was done. I killed him.
I am a Pharisee, and I killed him. I knew he was innocent, and I still killed him. He threatened to believe system I'd always had. He threatened my way of life. He threatened my influence and my power. So I trumped up charges against him. I brought many false witnesses. I stirred up a mob, and I got the Roman officials to hang him on a tree. I killed him.
I am Barabbas, and I killed him.
I am a thief, and I killed him.
I was a notorious prisoner, sentenced to die, and rightfully so, for I had murdered many.
I was a notorious prisoner, sentenced to die, and rightfully so, for my crimes were numerous and undeniable.
The mob could have had me killed, but my life was traded for his, even though he was innocent.
I mocked him, even as he hung on the cross next to mine. I mocked him, even though he was innocent.
He could have saved himself right there if he had merely spoken the right words to Pilate.
I am convinced he could have saved himself right there if he had merely spoken the word. Instead, he turned and forgave me and told me I would be with him in paradise.
It could be said that his life was given for mine.
It could be said that his life was given for mine.
I killed him.
My sin killed him.
I am me. I am you.
I am us.
And you killed him.
My sin drove the nails.
Your sin drove the nails.
Our sin drove the nails.
He died because I rebelled against God, because I was not interested in walking in his ways, because I chose a course that took me away from God. And there was only one way back. A sentence of death had to be served. And so God came down
in the form of a man to serve the sentence, to die in your place, to endure sting after sting of your sin inflicted on his body, to be mocked and jeered by your sin again and again, to be spit on by your sin right on his face again and again. And after all that, to
take our sin upon his shoulders and stumble through the streets under the weight of them, to be stretched out across our sin and then nailed brutally to our sin. until his blood poured like a river over our sin. That's why he came.
And my sin killed him.
Your sin killed him.
Our sin killed him.
I am a centurion.
I am Mead.
I am a Pharisee.
I am you.
I am Barabbas.
I am a thief.
I am us.
And our sin killed him.
At this time, I invite our brother and sister to reflect. What good is about Good Friday? What does Good Friday mean to you? And what is the thing that you have been carrying around all those years? All the worry and burden, shame and guilt. Is it something that is so hard for you to let go? Bring them all to Jesus. And remember, no matter how serious it is, how shameful it is, how unspeakable it is, on this Good Friday, Jesus has taken them all for us. As we sing the following hymn, I encourage you to write down on the paper the burden, the shame and guilt that you wanted to let go and the sin that you want Jesus to forgive. Write it on the piece of paper and fold it up and leave it in the foot of the cross. When you have finished, you may go back to your seat and give thanks to God for taking up all our sins on this day. And in front of our merciful God, you don't need to carry it around on your shoulder.
Friday worship service has been concluded. Thank you.